Samir, I thank you for that. We're going to take a turn here and turn to Wilfred Frost at HQ on some of these reports regarding gunfire outside Parliament in the UK. Wilf?
Yeah, Carl, thanks very much for this. So the Metropolitan Police have confirmed in a tweet that they're treating this incident in the UK outside Parliament as a firearm incident. It comes after Reuters reported that two people have been shot near Parliament. Other news that we're seeing from this is that parliamentary activity has been suspended. Reuters and Sky News reporting sounds of bangs that sound like gunshots fired in the region, and that there were large crowds of people running away from Parliament initially. Westminster Bridge, which attaches just to where Big Ben at the top of Parliament has been closed, and an air ambulance has just landed, as you can see in that picture, on Parliament Square. Parliament Square just in front of the Houses of Parliament and just to the corner of where Westminster Bridge connects with the north side of the Thames River. Sky News also reported that they believed, although could not confirm, that the Prime Minister's motorcade had left the area at high speed. No confirmation whether that was indeed the Prime Minister's motorcade. And this is an ongoing story. We, of course, are continuing to try and confirm further details. Reuters, as you can see, confirming that shots have been fired outside the area. We're not sure how many people injured, but that air ambulance has landed just moments ago outside of Parliament, Carl.
All right, Wilf, we're going to look to you to keep us honest on details. Again, this is just breaking in the past few minutes. Wilfred Frost back at HQ. If you're just joining us, welcome to Squawk Alley. I'm Carl Quintanilla with John Fort. Byron, we value your insight all the time. It's good to have you on the program. We'll talk
good
to you soon.
Good to be here. Thank you, Carl.
And we're continuing to follow a developing story out of the UK right now. Wilfred Frost has more and some shots fired near Parliament. Wilf?
Kelly, yes, just to add to the details we brought you earlier, this is, of course, an ongoing developing situation, but the leader of the House of Commons, David Lidington, just announced in the chamber of the House of Commons on parliamentary TV that a police officer was stabbed and then the alleged assailant was immediately shot by police. He also confirmed that Parliament remains under lockdown, so those members that were still in the chamber are being held there. And within that, Transport for London has confirmed that the police asked Westminster, Transport for London, to shut down Westminster Underground station. Just listening to some coverage from Sky News, the reporter there was pushed back, to those that know the area, to House Ferry Road to the east of Parliament. That's quite a significant distance away from Parliament, and you can see in that shot those cars not moving. So the whole area in lockdown to quite a significant distance. House Ferry Road probably around about a quarter of a mile to the east, so a decent area they've cleared and not allowing cars into that particular area. Sky News also reported that the Prime Minister was in the divisional lobby when this happened, and that they believe she was evacuated from the area in the usual Prime Minister motorcade. That coming from Sky News in the last couple of moments. But the leader of the House of Commons, David Lidington, confirming a police officer was stabbed. The alleged assailant was shot almost immediately. Guys.
Wilf, no comment from the police on reports of a vehicle being part of this whole equation.
Not that I've seen so far. Scotland Yard has said that it was called to, quote, a firearms incident. Scotland Yard, of course, the head of the Metropolitan Police, saying that it was called to the firearms incident on Westminster Bridge amid several reports of someone injured. That's the official statement from the police. I would say, in terms of Sky News, has aired a significant interview with an eyewitness where they agreed with what you just said, Carl, in terms of a 4x4 crashing into the barriers. But that is just from an eyewitness account aired on Sky News that I've heard, that I haven't heard that confirmed by Scotland Yard. We do have a bite in terms of some of these details being confirmed. Let's listen into that.
What I am able to say to the House is that there has been a serious incident within the estate. It seems that a police officer has been stabbed, that the alleged assailant was shot by armed police. An air ambulance is currently attending the scene to remove the casualties. There are also reports of further violent incidents in the vicinity of the Palace of Westminster, but I hope colleagues on all sides will appreciate that it would be wrong of me here to go into further details until we have confirmation from the police and from the House Security Authority.
That was the Leader of the House of Commons, David Lidington. I should point out the Leader of the House of Commons is a member of the Cabinet. It's a sort of superficial role, someone that gets included in the Cabinet with that kind of title without having a clear brief themselves. But a member there of Theresa May, the Prime Minister's Cabinet, and clearly a lot of members of Parliament were there at the time. They're being kept in lockdown, those still there. We believe from reports from Sky News that the Prime Minister was in the General Building but not in the Chamber at the time. And they believe, although have not confirmed, that her motorcade was evacuated with her in it. That was the Leader of the House of Commons, of course, said that a police officer was stabbed, an alleged assailant shot. Seeing now that BBC's political editor, Laura Koonsberg, has said that they believe three or four gunshots in total. That coming just now from the BBC's political editor, Laura Koonsberg, guys.
Wilf, we'll come back to you. House of Commons being cautious with details, and we will do the same. Market reaction has been muted, I would argue. Stocks remain lower, down about 49 points. S&P down about a point. We'll get more on the details out of central London and the markets after a short break. Continue to watch for details out of central London. Let's get to Wilfred Frost at HQ.
Carl, thanks very much. I just want to recap. I'll first bring you the latest headlines and then we'll try and recap the whole thing. So the Leader of the House of Commons, David Lidington, just confirmed that the House of Commons has been adjourned for the day, but that the building remains on lockdown with nobody able to leave. One person that we know is safe and is not still in the building is Prime Minister Theresa May, the government spokesperson, confirming that and that she is safe. In terms of some of the other details, an air ambulance has arrived and the London Ambulance Service confirming that a number of other ambulances have been sent to the scene. You can see them, those yellow van-type buildings in that shot, in that shot there. Parliamentary Square has now been cleared of all traffic. You can see Parliamentary Square there. And what would be 500 to 1,000 typical people walking through there, tourists and others at this time, they have been cleared of the area. Westminster Tube Station has been shut. Now, to recap what we believe has happened based on various sources, Reuters, Sky News and others, is that an SUV drove along the pavement of Westminster Bridge, that a number of people were injured during that process. We have that is then the shot of the SUV that crashed into the barrier outside of Parliament. There's been another of separate shots that show ambulances and people being treated on the pavement of Westminster Bridge. This, of course, the separate shot of where it crashed and ended its journey. A man wielding a knife then stepped out wielding a knife. I'm not sure of the sex of the assailant at this stage, the gender of the assailant, wielding a knife, stepped out that a police officer was stabbed and that the alleged assailant was shot on scene by police officers. Those final details in terms of a policeman being stabbed and the alleged assailant being shot on scene have been confirmed by the Leader of the House of Commons, David Lidington. Guys.
Wilf, for those who don't know London well, maybe you can just describe the geography for us here. This is a highly concentrated urban part of the city, yes?
Absolutely right. I mean, the Houses of Parliament, Parliament Square, Westminster Bridge, which we're looking at the moment, is right in the heart of town. It's in Zone 1 of the Tube area, if you will, and, of course, a central area both for workers, for lawmakers and for tourists as well because of its proximity to the Houses of Parliament. What we're looking at the moment is Westminster Bridge in particular, which goes across the bridge and links then to the Parliament building. In terms of connects essentially directly with Westminster Bridge. It's where the car travelled across and then, of course, the stabbing of the police officer taking place just outside of Parliament in terms of the estate. Those split shots there showing, the same shot now at the moment in terms of where the car ended its journey just by the barrier outside of the Palace of Westminster, which remains, of course, in lockdown, albeit has been adjourned for the day.
Wilfred, will you just explain one more time the sequence of events here? There's just the one vehicle connected to the one assailant. Is that right? Just explain again how this went down.
That hasn't been confirmed to me based on sufficient number of sources. What we do know is that a vehicle drove down the pavement of Westminster Bridge and injured a number of people, people that we have seen being treated based on a separate shot, and that also a vehicle hit into that barrier. Someone stepped out of it with a knife and stabbed a police officer. We can assume it was the same vehicle. I haven't had that confirmed by sufficient sources yet, but it does seem highly likely that that would be the same vehicle involved with both incidents.
Wilf, how unusual is this type of violent incident in a location like this, around a landmark in London, for people who maybe aren't familiar with the state of crime or terrorism? We don't know which this might be yet over there.
Yeah, absolutely, John. I mean, listen, very, very rare, I would say, and very, very disturbing because of it for all people concerned at the scene or involved with Britain. And of course, the most notable attack Britain has faced was in 2005. We're not really describing this as an attack yet. I shouldn't suggest that. It could be a completely separate individual incident. But the most famous attack that London has faced was in 2005, the London bombings, July 2005. Of course, since then, London has been, relatively speaking, safe and free from these types of attacks. When you compare that to the last 2 years of things that have taken place in continental Europe, whether we talk about Paris or Brussels or attacks in the south of France. So in that sense, it comes as a big, fresh surprise to the people of London. And the Houses of Parliament, given, of course, the concentration of lawmakers, 10 Downing Street, where the Prime Minister lives just a stone's throw away from Parliament, of course, has an elevated security presence, which I suppose you could argue makes it more of a target for these types of things, but also more protected than other areas. And, of course, police on the scene acting very quickly, locking down a significant amount of the surrounding area, including Westminster Tube Station. And as you can see, the bridge, Parliament Square, have now empty of what would normally be very, very busy with workers and tourists alike.
Indeed. Wilfred, don't go too far away. We want to talk to Colonel Jack Jacobs with us on the phone today, NBC military analyst. Colonel, it's good to talk to you. I wish we were under different circumstances, but good morning.
Good morning.
So much we don't know at this point, but to the degree we can exercise some pattern recognition, what do these pictures say to you?
Well, we have to keep in mind that some time ago, ISIS suggested to supporters around the world that they conduct these kinds of operations and incidents, and several have occurred around the world, most notably in Europe. So anything is possible. We probably shouldn't read too much into it until we know more about it, but this follows the pattern of suggestions from ISIS to its supporters, particularly in Europe.
Colonel, I know people have been on edge, especially since the White House announced this ban about larger devices coming into this country from certain other countries. Is there a sense out there about ISIS having provoked people to commit more acts of terrorism against the U.S., against the U.K., against whomever lately, or are these all just disparate events?
Well, they're not mutually exclusive. They may be disparate events, but also they follow a pattern, and there's clearly no loss of animosity between supporters of ISIS on the one hand and everybody else on the other. There's one thing to keep in mind here, too, because we see these kinds of incidents much more frequently in continental Europe than we do in the United States and even in Great Britain. And one of the explanations is that that there's less support in places like Great Britain and the United States for ISIS. And one possible explanation for that is that in the United States and Great Britain, Middle Eastern immigrants are far more integrated into the social and political fabric of those countries than they are on continental Europe. And I've spoken to a large number of people who agree with that notion that while you're not going to have no incidents like this in Great Britain and the United States, you're far more likely to have the kind of attitudes among immigrants on continental Europe that'll give rise to these kinds of incidents.
And of course, we do want to point out at this point, we don't know what the nature of this incident was. We don't know the the gender of the assailant, what the motive might have been, whether this is a garden variety crime, just albeit at a time of heightened alarm, or whether this might be a terrorist motive. But I'm wondering, this seems to be a knife attack, at least from the details that we have at this point, preceded by a vehicle that was also running at people. What kind of difference is there at trying to mitigate that sort of an issue? I mean, aside from doing something to divert traffic across Westminster Bridge, which seems from my view of it not to be a simple thing to do, how do you stop this sort of thing from happening?
Well, it's very, very difficult to stop. We see even in Washington where not too many years ago, you could drive right up to the White House. You could drive down Pennsylvania Avenue. Now you can't do that, and it's very difficult even to walk past the White House now. And even that has not stopped incidents from occurring. We just had one. We had several, actually three, this past week. So in a place like London, where there's a great deal of traffic across the Thames divides the city more or less in half, it's impossible to restrict vehicular traffic. I mean, you could do it, but it would be it wouldn't be a very good idea, and certainly not pedestrian traffic either. So you're not going to be able to eliminate this sort of thing from happening entirely.
Getting a tweet now from the Metropolitan Police in the UK regarding this incident in Westminster. We are treating this as a terrorist incident until we know otherwise. Kelly.
And we're going to go to Eamon Javers, who's at the White House now with some more color from the Capitol. The president has been briefed. Eamon, what more can you tell us?
Yeah, Kelly, that's right. The president has been in a meeting on a different topic here at the White House this morning, but he was just talking to reporters. He told them that he's just gotten an update on London. He said that some big news having to do with London has just happened. And then he went in with his pre-planned remarks on a different topic here at the White House. But clearly, this president has been briefed. This meeting started about a half an hour late, I would say. So clearly, that they took some time on the president's schedule here to update him. We'll see that tape of the president talking about this in a few moments, guys.
Eamon, thank you. Colonel Jack Jacobs is still with us. You know, sir, you were just discussing, you know, some logistical issues at hand here as we continue to try to figure out exactly what even just happened on that scene.
Say again, I missed that. Sorry.
Yeah, we're talking a little bit about the logistical challenges of handling an issue like this, not only the density of the population, but obviously Westminster Bridge. And police trying to not only have access to the area to figure out what happened so that we can all figure out as well, but then keeping the public safe.
Yeah, it's extremely difficult logistically to control traffic in a place like the center city in London. But think about this. It's late in winter and early in spring, and there are not nearly as many people, particularly tourists, in London as there would be in just a couple of months. So not to put too fine a point on it, that this could have been very much worse had this been at the height of the tourist season. Anybody who's been in London would know that the place is actually jam-packed, particularly this area, jam-packed with tourists at that time. So there's something to be said for this happening at this time. But controlling traffic in London in certain respects is extremely difficult because of the multiplicity of roads in that area. One good thing is that they have extremely good mass transit, and so the large majority of people who work in London, who live in London, live outside of London, use mass transit. And so the number of people actually walking across any of the bridges across the Thames is relatively low. In a place like a large city in the United States where you don't have as good mass transit, it would have been very much more crowded than it is in London.
Colonel, not looking to connect dots by any means, but this is happening on a week where we got that new electronics ban on certain airlines coming inbound to the U.S. The U.K., of course, joined the U.S. in that ban. Does it point to overall a rise of activity as relates to security concerns and alerts?
Well, I haven't spoken to anybody, and I haven't seen myself. I haven't spoken to anybody who said that there's been an increase in chatter or traffic or encouragement to conduct these kinds of operations among the enemies of the West. And so it may just be a coincidence. And indeed, those people who are disaffected, whether they're disaffected about this kind of ban of laptops and so on, or they're just annoyed with Brexit, they don't need any encouragement from anybody to do something silly.
And here's the Metropolitan Police tweeting, incident in Westminster, we are treating this as a terrorist incident until we know otherwise. MP Sir Gerald Howarth had said the House was in the middle of a vote when the session was suspended. Members were locked in. He said it appears to be very serious. The leader of the House told them it's been confirmed one police officer was stabbed. It appeared a car was coming towards the House of Commons, mowing down pedestrians, to borrow their phrase, on the way. And the driver then got access to the parliamentary estate, stabbed a police officer, and was shot. We now can hear what the president had to say about this.
Having some big news having to do with London, so it just happened. Well, thank you very much. Appreciate you being here. It's a great honor, very great honor. I want to thank Vice President Pence, Secretary Tom Price, and Administrator Seaman, Verma. He's done an incredible job, by the way, for all of the time and energy that we're put into repairing.
I guess we're not going to listen to the president making comments.
In the House.
I'm told that was the president's only reference to the London attack. He'll continue to make comments about the AHCA, of course, as that vote looms in the House tomorrow night. So, Colonel, I assume we can count on the president being well briefed, first and foremost. But as we go forward, I wonder how you would rate the quality of the interaction between U.S. and U.K. law enforcement at this stage.
Well, you raise a significant point here. The fact of the matter is that no matter what the relationship is between the head of one state and the head of another, the military establishments operate extremely closely, not just between the United States and Great Britain, the United States and most other countries, certainly all the countries with whom we are allied, operate continuously, exchange information regularly, if not continuously, and have a large number of potential operations for which we have plans in various areas of the world where we have planned to operate in conjunction with other militaries in those countries. And we practice these plans all the time. So we're talking right now to everybody who might have a concern about this and with whom we might operate, that includes Great Britain and those countries on continental Europe as well.
Our Eamon Javers is standing by in Washington. Eamon, we played that tape from the president. He very, very briefly addressed this issue. I wonder if he has to wait like the rest of us to find out exactly what's happened. We might hear more from him later on.
Well, our understanding is that he did get briefed. He said in that statement that he had been getting some information about what had been going on in London. Not clear exactly what he's been told as of right now. But, Kelly, you just saw in that tape an example of what White Houses have to deal with all the time, which is handling multiple different high-interest, high-impact items of news at the same time. And the president here is holding a meeting dealing with health care. He's got a number of conservatives coming in to meet with him here shortly to talk about their votes on this dramatic vote on his health care bill tomorrow. At the same time, he's got to get this briefing on what's going on in London and deal with our allies there, our military alliance, and figure out what's happened in London and whether there's any implications for the United States based on what's happened. And you guys just talked about the idea that the U.S. government took steps this week to impose a ban on certain electronic equipment being included on airplanes coming from about 10 different airports throughout the Middle East. That was an indication that U.S. intelligence saw something that they didn't like and felt they needed to step up their security posture. Not clear whether that has any relation to what's happened now in London, but we did see the UK follow suit with the United States after that ban was announced earlier this week. So clearly, U.S. intelligence and British intelligence work very, very closely together, and we'll see what they can piece together about what's happened here and what might be next, if anything.
Eamon, you speak with security experts all the time. It strikes me that this sort of incident or attack is among the most low-tech low coordination. We're talking about a vehicle here and a knife. From what we know thus far, no firearms necessarily involved in the alleged assailant, and no necessarily large group of people involved. What sort of reaction, political and otherwise, should we expect to this sort of an incident, which is different from some kind of coordinated attack involving a number of people, perhaps something that we might have picked up signals about from electronic communication?
Well, I think the political reaction is going to depend more on the details of what's happened here. As we learn those, you might see that the tenor of the reaction start to shift. But clearly, you make a good point, John, which is that this kind of an attack, if it just involved vehicles and knives and a couple of people, maybe one or two, as few as that, this is one of the hardest types of attacks for officials to prevent. It doesn't require a wide circle of people involved in planning. It doesn't require a lot of advanced logistics. It certainly doesn't require the movement of large amounts of money. All of those are things that intelligence agencies can spot in advance and take steps to intervene when they see them. In this case, this is simply outside of a security perimeter in an unsecured area in a major global city. That is very, very difficult to do anything at all to stop. The so-called lone wolf attacks are the ones that intelligence officials fear the most because they're the most difficult to isolate, predict, and do anything about. And in response, law enforcement and intelligence have to do exactly what you're seeing right here, which is immediately tend to the people who've been victimized by this, but also secure the area and figure out in real time what they're dealing with and who else might be involved, whether there's a second wave, whether this is a distraction from something else that might be planned, or whether this is the end of it right now. All of those things are things that they have to deal with in real time in what is it apparently a very dangerous situation here in London.
Indeed. Everything you're saying, Eamon, about soft targets, about the playbook that ISIS has given its followers, using an SUV to plow into pedestrians. I mean, we've seen it in Nice and some other high-profile cases. And we ask this question every time, but it does make you wonder to what degree either the U.S. or UK or other cities at risk have to fortify areas they never thought they'd have to fortify.
Well, you can't fortify everything, Carl. I mean, ultimately, we live in a free society. The people in London live in a free society. You have to have vehicles. You have to have movement. You have to have businesses be able to do business. At the end of the day, you know, you can move the security perimeter around, but there's always going to be some area that's outside the security perimeter, and you have to have that in order to have a free society. So there's only so much you can do to secure everything. And the answer to this, when you talk to the intelligence experts, is aggressive intelligence, finding out where the people are who might be sympathetic to the ISIS call for attacks, finding those people, putting them under surveillance, and making sure that they don't have the opportunity to do something like this. But it's just very, very difficult. It's a very big world out there. There are a lot of people. There are a lot of leads. You can't follow everybody all the time. And you can't shut down traffic in the center of a major city. You can't stop people from buying knives. You can't monitor everybody who's walking on a sidewalk. All of those things would be impossible to do. So for law enforcement and intelligence, this puts them in a difficult position of playing defense. And what they tell you when they talk about this is they'd rather play offense. They would rather be conducting surveillance, going after people they think might have contacts with ISIS, and that sort of thing, Carl.
Eamon, don't go too far. We continue to watch this. By the way, we're keeping our eye on the markets. Minimal movement here, but the S&P has gone positive. We want to check in with CNBC's Willem Marks, who is on the scene in London. Willem, can you tell us what you're seeing? We're going to come back to Willem Marks once we can get the audio worked out. Obviously, it's a very difficult area. You can imagine the chaos right now regarding law enforcement just trying to. There's reports on social media about subway disruptions as pedestrian traffic's being blocked a lot of places.
And there's a major tube stop right there. I was in this very location just 2 months ago. Again, talking about January, it's only March. This is not even the high season. It is packed. There's pedestrians everywhere. It's one of the busiest thoroughfares in all of London. It's the center of activity for the government. It's the center of activity for tourism. And I think we can hear Willem Marks now. So let's try him again. He's on the scene with us. Willem.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. This is a very popular tourist destination. Westminster Bridge behind me, leading over to the Palace of Westminster, the House of Parliament. That iconic image of Big Ben, seemingly the scene of tragedy this afternoon here in London. We've seen a number of people being pulled off the bridge on stretchers. As you can see, a huge number of ambulances, a significant police presence, helicopters above us, and a large number of armed policemen, both on this bridge and then closer to the Palace of Westminster, where there was this incident as well. Seems to be two separate events that have taken place, one involving a vehicle going across the bridge, trying to mow people down. Essentially, that's why we've had a huge number of casualties on the bridge. We've also then seen this incident where an intruder got inside the security perimeter of Westminster. He was dealt with by police. They are saying, the Metropolitan Police here in London, this is being dealt with as a terrorist incident.
Willem, your reporting then suggests these are two separate things that happened at the same time. Does that suggest a coordination between two separate individuals?
Not clear at this point whether there's one individual involved in the vehicle attack as well as the stabbing, or whether there's two separate people involved in that. We'll have to learn more over the next few minutes and hours as that unfolds. But certainly the impact here in central London, I cannot emphasize the police presence here. I've never seen anything like it in my years living and growing up in London.
How common is it to have a lockdown like this in Parliament, Willem?
Pretty rare. And, you know, there's a huge amount going on in our legislature at the moment, as you can imagine, involving Brexit. We've got a series of hearings that have been suspended. The Commons was in session when they said they heard shots fired. The Leader of the House, David Lidington, saying they've been that this attack has taken place inside the security perimeter. A policeman has been involved. He's been injured. The assailant has been dealt with. It's very unclear now, with Parliament on lockdown, what will happen to the MPs in there. There's also reports that the Prime Minister was hustled into a car. There's video emerging of that, with eight undercover armed policemen helping her get into a vehicle not too far from the Houses of Westminster.
Willem raises a great point. We know that May spokesman has said that they would trigger Article 50 by the 29th. We know nothing at this point, but I can't imagine many would be surprised if, in fact, this were related to at least the hearings that Willem mentions.
At the same time, I simply look at this and wonder. Now, we've seen this in France. We've seen this in Germany. Is it the UK's turn now to experience what it's like when somebody targets a heavily crowded pedestrian area, and as is suggested, on a bridge, no less, where there is nowhere to go?
Well, I think Willem's going to stick around. Let's get some additional perspective on the We're trying to continue getting additional perspective. We'll continue to effort that. But as you said, these incidents involving vehicles on the street, they're becoming more and more common. We saw it in Nice. We're seeing it here. Interesting, Kelly, that there can be such broad impact from an incident. We don't know if there was more than one person involved. There doesn't appear to be.
But as we know from Nice, you only need one person involved sometimes for the number, dozens of casualties in that situation. And unfortunately, the inspiration, the copycat attacks that we've seen since.
Yeah, and from what we've seen so far, there's the hope, at least, that this is not on the scale of Nice. We do continue to watch these developments.
All right, Eamon Javers, you still with us?
Yeah, I'm here, Carl. And one of the things that we're trying to effort right now, figure out, is whether or not we're going to hear from President Trump about all of this. You would imagine that they will have the best possible information here at the White House about what's going on and whether or not there's any threat related to this incident here in the United States. We're waiting to see whether the White House suggests that the president will make a statement on this at some point today.
We would expect so. I just wonder. It's way too early to think about policy ramifications, but you can't ignore how this might move the needle or the appetite to see various security measures put in place, either on a broader scale or on a faster scale.
And the interesting thing, I mentioned I was
there.
Well, that's right. 2 months ago, and one of the things happening at that time were massive protests and demonstrations against President Trump for his first go at the so-called Muslim ban. So I believe, Carl, the right question to ask is absolutely how this affects all the politics in the UK, in the US, and worldwide. Earlier, David Lidington, the House of Commons leader, made some remarks about what they knew at that point. Let's take a listen.
What I am able to say to the House is that there has been a serious incident within the estate. It seems that a police officer has been stabbed, that the alleged assailant was shot by armed police. An ambulance is currently attending the scene to remove the casualties. There are also reports of further violent incidents in the vicinity of the Palace of Westminster, but I hope colleagues on all sides will appreciate that it would be wrong of me here to go into further details until we have confirmation from the police and from the House security authorities about what is going on. I shall endeavour to do the very best I can, both at the dispatch box and by communicating with my opposite numbers in other political parties, to ensure that members are kept aware of what is happening. But at the moment, the very clear advice from the police and the Director of Security in the House is that we should remain under suspension and that the chamber should remain in lockdown until we receive advice that it is safe to go back to normal procedures.
Joining us on the phone right now, Elizabeth Piper, is Reuters UK chief correspondent who is inside Parliament. We appreciate your time. Thank you very much for joining us. Can you tell us what you know at this point, where you are?
Well, as you can imagine, it's all been fairly confusing as to what happened. We're sitting in the oldest wing where we can see the exit where the incident happened. It was a normal day, and then all of a sudden there was a loud crash followed by several loud bangs and then a loss of movement. We saw two people on the ground. One was receiving CPR, the other one was covered in blankets, and they have both been taken off in ambulances.
Elizabeth, you're inside Parliament right now, part of this lockdown, presumably. What are they telling you?
We're in lockdown. Basically, a large group of armed officers entered the parliamentary estate shortly after the incident and went inside. So we can, you know, I haven't got this confirmed, but we think that they are just checking that there are no assailants in the building. We are not allowed to move out, and all the doors have been locked.
Elizabeth, what is the likely conversation on the street that was going on before this that is likely to continue after? Of course, we don't know details yet about the extent of the casualties and injuries involved here, but give us a sense of the political climate that this has happened in.
Well, as you know, last year in June, Britain voted to leave the European Union. It's been a time of immense change, even though the negotiations haven't even started. And in terms of security, Britain has been on its second highest level of severe for quite some time. In 2013, two British Islamists were stabbed a soldier to death. This is something that we've not become accustomed to, but it is something that, you know, it has become part of contemporary life.
And finally, Elizabeth, where are you physically right now? Where within the building do they have you or the press?
Well, we have all the press sit in different offices, so we're in the Reuters office overlooking Parliamentary Square where the incident happened.
We were talking to one of our correspondents outside who was referencing how busy the schedule was in Commons this week. Related to hearings, I assume some of that must have been regarding Article 50 and Brexit. Was there something on the agenda today that might have provoked something like this from someone with a malicious intent?
No, the only event of note really in Parliament today was what's called Prime Minister's question time, and that's when the opposition and other lawmakers asked the Prime Minister pressing questions of the day. But I don't think there was anything specific on the agenda that you can conflate.
Elizabeth, is it true that UK police officers aren't often carrying weapons?
They do carry weapons on the parliamentary estate, but most policemen, well, policemen and women, do not normally carry weapons, yeah.
It's been suggested by another colleague who's there on the ground that one of the first things the public is going to look at this and think about is why not, you know, why don't they all have weapons? Is there some political debate there that's kept them from doing so?
It's not really a debate like the one you have in America, really. I think there's a lot of resistance for the police to have weapons. It seems that many people suggest that might escalate these kind of problems. I'm sure it will be debated again. I'm not sure there will be much change.
Have you spoken to any members of parliament since this happened?
No, I'm afraid I've been manning the story.
I'm sure access is limited, and obviously your vantage point is limited just because of where you are and your lack of freedom to move. But from what you can tell, how does this security apparatus that's been put in place compared with past events in London?
In terms of what, sorry?
In terms of the security that's been deployed around the area.
Well, it was pretty immediate and it was pretty substantial. There were a lot of armed officers, you know, basically guarding, and they moved in very quickly.
Elizabeth Piper with Reuters. We know it's a busy day for you. We appreciate your time. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you.
Scott Wapner is going to take over our coverage here as we approach noon on the East Coast. If you're just joining us, this incident being treated as terror by London police, gunfire outside the UK Parliament, a car hitting pedestrians on Westminster Bridge. Prime Minister May is safe. The assailant reportedly shot by police. And an incident that, as of yet, Scott, hasn't rocked markets. S&P pretty steady.
Indeed, Carl, we maybe saw a slight move lower in the pound, but in terms of market reaction, that was really it. As we continue, thank you very much to look at these live pictures now from London. Our breaking news continues this hour. Welcome to the Halftime Report. I'm Scott Wapner. We are following the latest developments on the incident in London near Parliament. Let's get right to Willem Marx, who is on the scene right there. Willem, what do you see?
We're behind a police cordon about 400 yards from the Palace of Westminster across Westminster Bridge. That is a very popular tourist destination. People come, walk across this bridge, get a photo of the iconic Big Ben Tower attached to the Palace of Westminster. And behind me, you can probably see just a huge number of emergency vehicles. We've got ambulances here waiting to treat injured. We've seen at least two people carried off on stretchers. One of them not moving. I can't tell you more than that at this stage, but the reports are there are at least a dozen injuries on this bridge because a vehicle crossed over the bridge at speed, aiming to knock people down. At least one of the eyewitnesses to that has told me some of the details there. He saw bodies being pushed out of the way by the vehicle. Across the bridge, you have a fence perimeter around the Palace of Westminster, and that's what seems to have been breached by at least one intruder. That is the estate of Parliament, the leader of the House of Commons here, talking about the fact there's been an intruder inside the parliamentary estate. He has stabbed a policeman and has been shot. His condition, we don't have any more details about at the moment, but obviously there's been air ambulances arriving on the scene to treat both the people inside the parliamentary estate and then also these huge numbers of ambulances here. There's a massive armed police presence across this entire region. This police cordon stretching across the River Thames here. We can see it every single street going up to the river up here. Parliament Square has been closed down. Whitehall has been closed down. The area is off limits to all but police and emergency services while they try to do their job.
Said as well, Willem, that in your many years in London that you had never seen such a massive police presence of this magnitude, right?
That's absolutely right. I mean, this is unprecedented. People here I've been talking to saying it's like you see in a movie. We've got helicopters above us at the moment, huge numbers of priests coming in and out in their emergency vehicles. Worth noting, I think, that it's a year since the Brussels attacks. So this marks the first anniversary since those attacks. I was in Brussels yesterday and the day before that. Huge police and military presence there across the city. We're seeing this across Europe now.
Willem, thank you very much. I want to jump over to our Wilfred Frost, who's been covering this incident from the very beginning, which, Wilfred, we know occurred around 2:40 local time In the UK, and given the clocks changing here over the last week or so, it's about 10:40 in the morning, a four-hour difference rather than the 5 we're so used to. What's the very latest?
Exactly. So it's about 4 p.m. local time, as you correctly say. And as Willem already reported, the House leader of Parliament saying that Parliament is in lockdown. Therefore, there are still a significant number of parliamentary MPs inside the chamber. I'd say well over 100 based on pictures tweeted out in the last hour or so. One member of Parliament and leader of the government, of course, that we know is not inside is Prime Minister Theresa May. A couple of hours ago, a government spokesperson confirming she was safe. And more recently, the BBC's Andrew Neil reporting about her evacuation from the site, saying the Prime Minister was bundled out of the House of Commons by security detail with automatic weapons drawn and whisked away via the Lord's exit. Separately, Sky News reported seeing her motorcade leaving the scene very, very swiftly, of course, and most lately a statement from a government spokesperson saying that the Prime Minister is monitoring the situation from 10 Downing Street, of course, her official residence, which is very, very close indeed to the site overall, outside, of course, of people like her that are still relatively close to the situation. We have seen the whole site cleared, unprecedented level of clearing to decent distances away. Westminster Tube Station remains closed as well. Now, we have, of course, heard from the U.S. State Department on this issue. They say they're closely following the concerning situation outside of the UK Parliament. They say their hearts go out to those affected, and they urge US citizens in London to contact family members and loved ones to notify them. They stand ready to help where needed. The embassy in London's monitoring the situation closely. Scott.
Wilfred, thank you. We'll jump back to you certainly as needed. Let's get down to Washington now, to the White House, where Eamon Javers is there. Eamon.
Scott, we know that President Trump has been briefed on the situation in London, and that's because he was heading into a meeting on a separate topic here at the White House. That meeting delayed about 20 minutes to a half an hour. When the president came in, though, he said that he had been receiving some information on the situation in London. I think we have tape now of what the president had to say. Here's what he said.
Sorry, we're just getting an update on London. Having some big news having to do with London, so it just happened.
The president then carrying on with the meeting as planned here at the White House. So clearly he's getting some information, Scott. The question is whether now we'll see a larger statement from this White House about what's going on in London and what, if any, the U.S. response will be. One of the things that we've been following this week, of course, is the U.S. government's efforts to block certain airlines from allowing passengers to carry laptops and electronic devices on flights in from certain airports in the Middle East. That's something that U.S. intelligence has said that they did because they saw some effort among terror groups to try to use explosives disguised as electronics on those flights. No indication whether what we're seeing here in London is any relation to that, but clearly we know that U.S. intelligence has seen something this week that they didn't like, and the U.S. government taking some steps to tighten up security just this week. So we'll wait and see what else the White House has to say, what else the president has to say here at the White House, Scott.
We've yet clearly to hear from anybody from the Homeland Security Department. Do we know anything about the level, the threat level here in the United States, whether that has been raised just as a result of what's taken place across the Atlantic?
We don't have any response so far in the immediate present tense. And just looking around the White House here, I can tell you that there's no visible additional security here in this facility, which is obviously highly secure at all times. So there doesn't seem to be any immediate sense of reaction here on the ground at the White House, Scott. But we'll wait for authorities to tell us what they think the threat level is, if any, here inside the United States. Obviously, we have seen things like this in the United States just within the past year. I mean, I covered the Orlando shooting last summer in Florida, and that had a very similar vibe to it in the sense that you had a group of people who were going through just normal daily life who were subjected to horrific attack. And there's really just very no way for people to prepare themselves for that, defend against it. They're caught completely unawares. And you have the sense that that's what happened here in London as well. As you saw these people just walking across a bridge, and suddenly in comes this violent attacker bent on doing harm. It's something that authorities have a real difficulty in defending against or dealing with, because it's very hard to predict and to intercept once it gets started.
Sure, Eamon, thank you. I want to go back to our Wilfred Frost, who's at the breaking news desk. Wilfred, first and foremost, if you could give us an idea, our viewers an idea of the type of area in London that we're talking about, one heavily populated, certainly with government officials, but also tourists, residents, business people and the like.
Absolutely right, Scott. Not just workers and parliamentarians, but also tourists. I mean, not just is the Houses of Parliament itself a huge tourist attraction, but Parliament Square, and then just adjacent to that, Westminster Abbey as well. Thousands of tourists visit both of those locations every single day. So an unprecedented clearing of that area done by police over the last couple of hours. Also, just on that note, BBC's Andrew Neil reporting that heavily armed police are now checking every room of Parliament at this current moment, so that's ongoing. To summarize more broadly, of course, the area, the other place in focus has been Westminster Bridge, which connects across the Thames right to where Parliament is. There have been, of course, people mowed down on the pavement there by a vehicle. We also have a separate image of a vehicle that crashed into the barrier of Parliament. We don't know if that had that confirmed, but that was indeed the same vehicle. And of course, that reporting of someone who managed to break into the parliamentary estate, past the barrier, wielding what was described by some eyewitnesses as a 7 to 8 inch kitchen looking knife, and stabbed a police officer and was shot. The alleged assailant was shot by armed police at the scene. As I already reported, of course, the Prime Minister was in the parliamentary estate at the time that this happened, and it was reported by the BBC's Andrew Neil that was bundled in out of the Commons with automatic weapons drawn by her security detail, whisked away, and that a Prime Minister spokesperson has confirmed that the Prime Minister is safe and is monitoring the situation from Downing Street, her official residence, which of course is very close to the parliamentary area either way.
Wilfred, thanks. I want to go back now to the scene in London where Villa Marx is standing by. Villa, if you can give us an idea, help us understand the political climate that has been in Europe. Obviously, we know about the Brexit, but they are in the midst of French elections as well, and a hardline candidate in Marine Le Pen trying to win that election there. And I wonder how these pictures and this incident may impact voters in France, and what voters in the UK may be thinking today.
Well, you know, you think of the context, of course. You had the Dutch elections not so long ago. You had Geert Wilders there, a very anti-immigrant candidate. He was pretty soundly defeated by the Liberal Party there. However, you're right, we've got Marie Le Pen in this big race in France. She's doing pretty well as one of the two front runners in the numbers we've seen recently. She has been vociferously anti-immigration for a long time. Many people seeing that as an attack on some of the minority populations in France. And as you imagine, there will be a lot of questions being asked in France after this incident across the pond. We've got some events coming up just next week, actually, in Paris, between the London mayor and the Paris mayor, talking about maintaining and strengthening links between the two cities. This is not the kind of conversation they want to be having.
Wilfred, we still have Wilfred Frost with us.
Yes, Scott.
Wilfred, I'd like to get your comments on that as well, as you follow what's taking place in the both in the UK and in France in terms of the political races and the climate.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Clearly, Scott, it's going to have an impact on people's mindsets as they do go to the polls. I suppose we should clarify that the Metropolitan Police have said they are treating this as a terrorist incident. However, they also said, the Metropolitan Police, the motivation not yet known. So I suppose as more details come out, we will be able to gauge how much of an influence this may or may not have on the voters. The next ones, of course, to go to the polls are the French. And after the televised presidential debate just a couple of nights ago, we did see the centrist candidate Emmanuel Macron edge forward 26.5%, the latest polls, to Marine Le Pen, the far-right leader, on 25%. But it is a big question. Of course, it's an issue that has rocked continental Europe in the past couple of years more than it has rocked the UK. And Prime Minister David Cameron, the previous Prime Minister, and the current Prime Minister Theresa May have both said on a number of times that a number of attacks have been thwarted over the last couple of years in the UK. So it's not the through want of people trying, not trying to attack. It's just that the security services, thankfully, have been more adept at dealing with them. I just want to add one further detail that we're getting, Scott, and that is a statement from Buckingham Palace, palace confirming that the Queen is currently at Buckingham Palace and indeed monitoring the situation. No further details on that, but she is at Buckingham Palace. Also, very close, I know we've shown a map of that, to the whole situation, not quite as close as 10 Downing Street, where Prime Minister Theresa May currently resides herself.